been hiding. You just walk down the middle of the street, huh? Two guys down there on the right, and two guys down there on the left. There's four guys down there all together. We did all right, huh? What a team.
Well, if you were ducking, or in case you didn't know, those were Clint Eastwood and Burt Reynolds as Dirty Harry teams with Smokey's Bandit for the first time in City Heat, a new gangster movie set in Kansas City back in the 30s. And City Heat is just one of four big new holiday movies we'll be reviewing this week on Sneak Previews. I'm Jeffrey Lyons.
And I'm Neil Gabler. As Jeffrey just said, we're going to be reviewing City Heat, which is actually a comedy with Eastwood and Reynolds doing send-ups of their macho images. And we've got Runaway, a futuristic adventure with Tom Selleck. We'll also look at Mass Appeal. That's a comedy drama starring Jack Lemmon as a popular priest who has a run-in with a rebellious young seminarian. And we'll have Mickey and Maude, with Dudley Moore playing a bigamist who's got two pregnant wives. And finally, Michael Medved will be awarding his golden turkeys to the worst movies of the month.
Well, in Runaway, which is set, I suppose, a few years hence, Tom Selleck plays a police sergeant who specializes in stopping runaway or defective robots. But soon he uncovers a sinister scheme hatched by an evil scientist to create a new heat-seeking bullet program, that is, to seek and kill specific victims. Now, in this scene, Selleck's obtained the master computer plates needed to create more of those killer bullets, as well as the scientist's girlfriend, and he's about to swap them for his partner, all in the middle of a crowded Japanese restaurant.
Send Jackie over to me.
You sent Thompson first.
What's the matter, Sergeant? Don't you trust me? Come on, I haven't got all night.
It's my insurance policy.
Send Thompson.
At the same time.
Go ahead, Jackie. What's the matter? Something wrong?
These aren't all of them, Ramsey.
Nobody does that to me.
Nobody.
That mad scientist, by the way, the killer, is portrayed by none other than Gene Simmons. No, not the actress, but the male Gene Simmons, lead singer, of course, of the rock group Kiss.
Now, your favorite group.
My favorite group. Now, later, he strikes a final bargain with Selleck. To get those chips called templates, which he needs, he's kidnapped Selleck's son and taken the boy to a construction site, which he's booby-trapped with deadly spider robots.
Let him go.
Now!
On the elevator, Bobby.
I want to stay with you, Dad.
Get on the elevator, son. Push the button to go down. Stay away from the edge.
The templates, Ramsey.
After he's down. After he's safe.
There's a little problem about that, Sergeant. I can't have any witnesses. It's too messy. The spiders have been programmed to kill the first person that comes out of the elevator. Oh, they'll let you in, but they won't let you out. And there's nothing you can do about it,
Bobby!
Sergeant. Stop the elevator! Push the button!
What's the matter?
Stop the elevator! Push the button!
They don't work! None of them work!
You can't stop it, Ramsey. I fixed the elevator. Look on your monitor. You may get a better view.
Dad? Oh.
Bobby! Ever see him kill somebody, Ramsey? It's really impressive. They're loaded with acid.
Bobby!
Well, Runaway is innovative in spots. It's got some creative ideas, I suppose. Those robots, that gun which shoots around corners, some glitzy special effects, and the horrifying idea it poses that no matter how sophisticated machines may be, They're potentially evil if they're the products of evil human beings. Now, Michael Crichton, who made Runaway, often has directed science fiction thrillers and written them as well, like Coma or Westworld. But beneath the futuristic glitz here, the screenplay is just a predictable cops and robbers tale, the type which turns up on TV. Selleck is TV's reigning hunk furthermore, but on the screen...
I thought you were television's reigning hunk.
Well, we're not talking about public television. On the screen, he's a dull, one-dimensional hunk who does nothing to develop his standard hero role, except for that sequence there, his best in the movie. And Gene Simmons, as the heavy, just frowns or snarls. He used to be a teacher in the New York City school system, which may be the reason why. Runaway is flashy on the outside, but it's empty on the inside.
I disagree with you about Selleck. I think for the first time on screen, he seems comfortable, and in the same way that he seems comfortable in Magnum P.I. And I also think that this movie has a lot of good action. For me, the problem is the villain. You said that all Gene Simmons does is snarl. I don't think he's shrewd enough. I don't think he's got enough finesse to really be a match for Selleck.
It's not even a function of the way his role is written. He's interesting looking at the beginning
really
of the picture,
is.
And then he doesn't do anything with it. I think Selleck is uninteresting throughout the movie, except for that scene, which I may have been responding to as a father, not as somebody watching an actor going through those emotions. I'm not sure. I just don't think he is interesting enough. Some of the other performances are interesting. I'm so tired of all the cliches of the angry superior in the police department berating him for getting himself into...
Well, but the action sequences are really well handled in this picture.
Yeah,
but that's not enough. The reason I'm voting no on this picture is because of Gene Simmons. And I guess it's a left-handed compliment to say that this is Tom Selleck's best movie so far, but it is.
So it's two no's anyway.
Two no's on this. Yeah, so I think this next movie is really about the most pleasant surprise out of this whole batch of Christmas movies so far that I've seen. It's a moving comedy drama called Mass Appeal. And it stars Jack Lemmon as a crowd-pleasing parish priest who knows how to give his congregation exactly what it wants, even if that means skimping on the spiritual things. Now, there happens to be a rebellious, self-righteous young seminarian who's not so fond of Lemmon's song and dance approach to religion. And he gets assigned to Lemmon so that Lemmon can teach him a little tact and diplomacy. Well, here, the seminarian, played by Jelko Ivanek, has just delivered his first sermon from Lemmon's pulpit, but he just couldn't restrain himself from attacking the parishioners for their complacency. And Lemmon is hopping mad.
Well, Mark, the parish poll is in. 80% of those interviewed, having heard the Spirit move you, feel that you and the Spirit should move each other to that rustic bakery in the mountains with the Trappists.
Father?
Well, they stopped coughing.
They also stopped breathing.
Muffin! What happened?
James Dean had his debut.
Mr. Hartigan and Father De Nicola are waiting.
I do not want to see Mr. Hartigan.
He's waiting.
I cannot cope with Mr. Hartigan right now.
Well, I don't think he'll leave until he talks to you.
No.
What did he say?
He said that they should take care of their own souls and stop making so much money.
Good for you. Shake them up.
Well, that's fine, Margaret. Why don't you join the revolution? You'll be working in a soup kitchen. Better get to Hartigan before he breaks my neck for keeping him waiting. You two stay away from each other.
Jack Lemmon is wonderful in this picture.
Yes, he is.
Now, Lemmon does try and teach his student how to get along, but he also begins to learn a few things himself, mainly that being popular doesn't amount to much if you have to sacrifice all your principles for it. And principles come into action when the seminarian admits to the local bishop that he's had bisexual affairs before coming to the seminary. Now, the bishop has decided to expel him. And in this scene, Lemmon, after hiding in his office with a bottle, decides to come to the boy's rescue.
Hello, Tom.
Nobody here seems to know where or how you are.
Well, I'm here and I'm fine. How are you?
I'm angry. You should not have given a sermon this day.
Well, let's calm down, Tom. After I can do what I want in my parish.
And you do. But I think a sermon about poached fish, even for you, is going overboard.
I thought it was a damn good sermon. I want him to give as many sermons as he can. Now, maybe you can't see it, but I can. Mark is going to be a very important priest.
No, he's not. He's not going to be a priest at all.
You're actually going to do it?
It's done.
Oh, you're making a big mistake.
We have enough priests in the church already who are either in the closet or worse yet, out of the closet and continue to be priests. This one was out, and now he's back in. I don't believe it.
You're being ridiculous. You're using the... The boy made a decision to be celibate. Celibacy is celibacy, even if your thing is goats. What? Goats. I tell you that he will keep his vows.
Are you keeping yours?
Monsignor, that's not...
There are limits, Tom, and I'm not going to be threatened. And I tell you that until I hear from an appropriate authority, this is my parish.
If I decide that that boy is going to give a sermon, that is what he's going to do. If I decide that I will give a sermon about Mark, that is what I will do. And I will not be intimidated by your Gestapo tactics.
I think you ought to leave, Tom.
Well, frankly, I didn't expect much from Mass Appeal because I didn't much care for the play it's adapted from, and I'm not the president of the Jack Lemmon fan club.
Oh, I am.
But this movie snuck up on me, and it really hooked me. Part of it is that it's so well acted by Ivanek and by Lemmon. And I don't think that Lemmon has ever given a better, truer, or more moving performance than the one he gives here. He's absolutely magnificent. And part of its appeal, I suppose, is personal, because it frames what I think is a very important issue, especially for someone on TV, popularity versus integrity. And Mass Appeal not only frames it, it dramatizes and it humanizes it with even-handedness and intelligence and a lot of emotion. Intelligence and emotion are a hard combination to beat, and I think Mass Appeal is one of the best pictures of the year. I am not hedging at all on that.
Well, I may be the president soon of the Jack Lemmon fan club because every one of his films makes me appreciate his talent more and more.
He's extraordinary.
He is extraordinary. He'll get Oscar nominated. I think he's the best thing in the film. Nevertheless, I think you're right. The film raises a lot of important issues. The young seminarian realizes that what people want out of religion isn't necessarily the same thing as what's good for them, and the lessons in life are not always pleasant, and people sometimes have to hear things that are not pleasant, and it's the popularity against the truth here that I like.
That what love really constitutes love is not just pleasing people, but caring enough about people to challenge them. It's
exactly
a movie about love.
Nevertheless, I like Jack Lemmon so much that I thought much of the picture was secondary to him, and that may be faint praise for the picture, and I hope
I don't think so.
It's still
I don't think so. I think the script is up to Jack Lemmon. I think the thing that this script does is it humanizes these positions so these people aren't walking position papers.
So for various reasons, I certainly hope that when Mass Appeal gets a national release, it does have a mass appeal and finds a wide audience.
I hope so. I love
it. And I think Lemmon's going to get an Oscar nomination at least. Well, now, at any given time as we go on to our next movie, at any given time in the world, two things are always happening. No, not Neil is seeing a movie. Somewhere, in some country in the world, a rerun of I Love Lucy is playing. That's true. And it seems Dudley Moore is shooting a new movie. Well, his newest is Mickey and Maude, in which he plays a TV reporter who specializes in fluff pieces. Now, he's married to Mickey, a prominent lawyer, played by Anne Reinking. He wants children. She wants a career. So depressed and frustrated, he has an affair with a beautiful cellist named Maude, played by Amy Irving. And she gets pregnant. And here, he tells his boss he's decided to divorce Mickey.
Mickey, where are you going to tell Mickey?
Oh, God. Perino's. She loves sautéed brains.
Perino's? That's a very expensive restaurant.
Yeah, well, I read somewhere that if you want to break off with your wife, go to a very expensive public place where she won't throw a tantrum. Come on, Leo.
Take it to Dodger Stadium. Save yourself $200, which you will soon be needing, by the way, to support a cellist and a baby.
What would you do, Leo, if you had to choose between them?
I've known Mickey almost as long as you have, Rob. I love Mickey.
Well, so do I, Leo. So do I. I mean, what am I supposed to say? Mickey, a decade is a long time to be intimate with another human being.
A little stiff, Rob. How about dear?
Dear? What do you mean, dear? I don't call her dear. She's a lawyer.
Oh. Counselor, I'm just not good enough
for
you.
Come on, Leo. Wait a minute. Sometimes in a relationship, things happen that neither party anticipates.
You've got the punch, now you need the pillow.
What do you mean?
You're gonna knock her out with this news. You need a pillow for her to land on.
Yeah, I suppose.
Mickey, I love you. I'll always love you.
Yeah.
These years with you, I've seen you blossom from a young girl into a mature woman.
No. I mean, she was always a mature woman, even at 25.
All right, you like, Mickey, I love you, I'll always love you. You like that, right?
Oh, well, Leo, it's all right, but it's not...
Mickey, I love you, I'll always love you.
And
I've knocked up a girl, I'm going to marry her, and I want a divorce.
Great, where's the pillow?
We'd like to name the baby after you.
Well, later, when Mickey tells him she, too, is pregnant, Dudley tells his mistress, Maude, he's getting divorced anyway. Then he fraudulently marries Maude. And in this scene, the bigamist, now saddled with two children on the way, takes wife number one for a checkup.
What's wrong? What is it?
I forgot my keys. I left them in the car.
Well, aren't you supposed to?
Well, yes and no. Oh.
Is something wrong? I'm just here for the phonogram.
What?
Mrs. Salinger?
Wow.
Everything okay?
Huh? Everything on schedule, 3 weeks from tomorrow.
Terrific.
I just got to check my appointment.
Okay, I'll wait.
There's Verbeck. This is my husband, Bob Salinger.
Your husband?
Remember your oath, Nurse Verbeck.
Nurses don't take oaths, Mr. Salinger.
Right.
Is Tuesday okay?
3 o'clock.
So you're going home?
No, I've got to go to work.
Ooh, it's thoughtful of you to come.
I thought you were her husband.
I am.
But she said you were her husband.
No, she said I was her husband's brother.
No, she didn't.
No, you didn't know that about her. Maud always leaves the last word off her sentences. It's very confusing if you don't know. Her whole family does that. You remember when she came in and said, how are you? Then good.
No.
Hi.
Just perfect.
Yeah, great. Everything's fine. Everything's fine. Oh, Nurse Verbeck, this is my husband.
So he keeps telling me.
Vicky and Maud is funny, darn funny. In fact, it's Dudley Moore's best movie since Arthur, which I grant you isn't saying very much, right, Neil? But he and Blake Edwards, who directed Mickey and Maud, have another comedy hit on their hands, I think. Sure, the twists and turns in the plot of Mickey and Maud are silly, contrived, and slapstick. And the movie starts off with Dudley Moore looking tired and perhaps fearful he's made still another dud. But soon the comedy engine revs up, and one situation gets more ridiculous than the next. By the time both women give birth the same day in the same hospital, with the same name and adjoining rooms, still unaware of each other's existence, with poor Dudley scurrying from one to the other, I was on the floor. Welcome back, Dudley Moore. One time, sneak preview's Falling Star. I'm still laughing.
This is a great idea for a farce, but I don't think that the movie knows what to do with it until it gets to that last scene that you're talking about, the last 15 minutes where both wives are in the same hospital, and that's very funny stuff. But this movie, you can see the plot grinding on. All the plot mechanics are showing. The pace is way too slow for a farce until you get to the last 15 minutes.
Yeah, but you've liked movies at the last because of a last speech or a last soliloquy. I mean, Garbo Talks, for instance.
By a whisker.
Nevertheless,
like
it's, then give that to me here. It saves the movie, even for people who like you who
but
can't put
Dudley. But we haven't confronted
Dudley
yet for me the real problem of this movie, the Dudley Moore problem. I find him utterly unconvincing because he brings no conviction to this whatsoever.
You're thinking of all his flops in between Arthur and this.
Oh, no. Well, he's earned that. He's come by that legitimately. I think that I don't like him.
Here he redeems himself.
I don't believe him at all in this
picture. I was laughing constantly, especially when he's talking to his boss.
Well, now we're moving on to something else. Now we've got one of the big Christmas blockbusters. It's an action comedy set in 1933 called City Heat, and it's a blockbuster because it teams up Clint Eastwood and Burt Reynolds for the very first time. Eastwood plays a detective who is so tough, bullets don't dare hit him. And Reynolds plays a fast-talking private eye who's so frightened, bullets can't hit him because he outruns them. Now, in this scene, a couple of thugs are after Reynolds at a diner while Clint is just trying to enjoy a peaceful coffee break.
Evening, Lieutenant.
Louie.
Coffee?
Yeah.
Hey. Somebody left the cage door open, huh?
Archie, how you doing?
It's good.
Cupcakes.
I guess that's what you're going to do.
Lieutenant, aren't you
going to
do anything?
How about a refill? You can take care of yourself.
I'm not disturbing you, am I? I got a situation here. Yeah.
Clint Eastwood is a great deadpan comedian there. Now, Reynolds escapes the trouble.
You do, really?
Yes, I do. I really do. I think not only in this movie, but in other pictures. Mm-hmm. But he's right back in trouble the very next day. That's because he's gotten a hold of a big gangster's business ledgers that document the mobster's illegal doings. And both the gangster and the gangster's rival are bidding for the books. Now, to put pressure on Reynolds, one of the gangsters kidnaps Reynolds' girl. And Reynolds, disguised as a wolf, goes on the offensive.
I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow you out.
Oh! sort of enjoyed City Heat, but I can't say that I'm really wild about it because it's another movie with a script so slender that it barely exists. This script isn't much more than a bundle of quips, and there are about three or four shootouts that not only seem endless, they are practically indistinguishable from one another, not to mention the fact that they break up the comic tone of the picture. But if you look at City Heat for what it is, which is a showcase for Eastwood and Reynolds, on that level, it's pretty good fun. And Eastwood's famous long fuse plays off of Reynolds' famous jitteriness perfectly. It's the pleasure of watching two old pros who know their appeal so well that they can parody it. In fact, I think they work so well together that I wish someone had actually written a movie for them. Because City Heat isn't a movie. It's a good-looking, good-natured game of Can You Top This?
You know, I agree with everything you say that's wrong about this picture, except I'm voting no on it. There's no chemistry here. My two cats, Bob and Ray, have more chemistry between them than Eastwood here does with Reynolds. I think they're trying to be another Newman and Redford, perhaps, and you can see how great The Sting was and how great Butch Cassidy was by comparing it to this. There's no fun in this picture.
I think
the gunfights are boring. They slow it down. They're trying to play Can You Top This at the expense of the movie. I didn't have fun until somebody started sprouting Henny Youngman jokes. That's the fun I had in this picture.
I'll grant you all of that, except I do think there's chemistry, and there are two reasons I'm voting yes on this movie. Clint Eastwood and Burt Reynolds.
If Clint Eastwood blinks his eyes, you're enthralled, Neil.
Not
I just
true.
Didn't have
Not
a good
true.
Time at this picture. Well, it's that time of the month again. Time for another visit to our projection booth, where critic Michael Medved is ready to bestow his winners of Golden Turkey Awards for the worst movies of the month. Michael?
As you go about your holiday shopping and look for just the right gift to give to people who have everything, how about a nice golden turkey to stuff into their stocking? Thank you, Moose. And ready or not, our runner-up is Loveline, a pretentiously romantic reworking of the old Romeo and Juliet story, where in place of Montagues and Capulets, we have rival rock bands from two Southern California high schools. The star-crossed lovers this time out are named Rick and, gag me with a spoon, Piper. Now, you may think that the male lead, Greg Bradford here, looks familiar to you. Maybe so, if you were unlucky enough to have seen his face on the cover of the Chippendales male stripper calendar. Here, he joins forces with his co-star, the immortal Mary Beth Evans, to overcome the opposition of friends and classmates by combining their two competing bands and making the already unendurable music twice as bad. Now, speaking of unendurable and twice as bad, I still cannot believe I actually sat through Crimes of Passion, this week's Golden Turkey Award winner. Rising star Kathleen Turner plays a sexually repressed yuppie clothing designer who tries to generate a little body heat by taking on a stimulating part-time job as a blonde, bewigged hooker in a Skid Row fleabag hotel. Her client list includes a suburban husband, whose wife, predictably enough, doesn't understand his problems, and also a deranged, murderous preacher who carries around an assortment of bizarre sexual implements along with his Bible in an adorable little black bag. Now, if you call Central Casting and say, we need a twitching, slobbering, homicidal maniac, who are they going to send you but our old pal, Tony Perkins?
Hello, Joanna.
What are you doing here? You have no right to be here.
Sure he does. Come on. Tony played Norman Bates, the homicidal maniac in the two Psycho movies. And he has carved out, or at least sliced out, a secure niche for himself in playing this sort of role. Director Ken Altered States Russell battled the ratings board to avoid an X rating for this movie, and eventually he settled for an R, obviously as in, are you kidding me? This turkey is no more erotic than the graffiti in a bus station men's room. And if you manage to miss it, that's just one more reason to count your blessings at this holiday season.
The movie itself is a crime. But now let's summarize how we felt about the movies we looked at this week. We agreed on Runaway, the futuristic police thriller with Tom Selleck disarming runaway robots. It's got some good action, but Jeffrey thinks Selleck is a stiff, and I thought the movie's villain was no match for Selleck, so two no's for different reasons. We agreed again on Mass Appeal, the comedy drama about a crowd-pleasing priest who's challenged by a sincere young seminarian. Jeffrey thought Jack Lemmon's performance would win him an Oscar nomination, but that it overshadowed the rest of the movie. I was moved by the performances, I was provoked by the issue, and I think it's one of the best pictures of the year. We disagree, though, on Mickey and Maude, the far starring Dudley Moore as a man with two wives, both of them pregnant. Jeffrey liked its wacky, fast-paced humor and thinks it's Dudley Moore's best movie since Arthur, faint praise. I thought it has 15 good minutes, but it's too slowly paced for a farce, and I found Dudley Moore totally unconvincing. And finally, we've got another disagreement on City Heat, teaming up Clint and Burt. Jeffrey thought there was no chemistry between Eastwood and Reynolds, and the screenplay was a jumbled mess. I admit it's not much of a movie, but I think Eastwood and Reynolds are both very funny, so one no and one mild yes.
A very mild yes.
It's for their fans.
Like you. Yeah. Next week, we'll take...